How's everybody this morning? I see a few visitors. We're so glad you're here this morning, and so glad everybody's here visiting with us and here this morning. This is a struggle. I left my glasses in my office, so if I make a mistake... Mary to the rescue. That's... Oh, I forgot about all these announcements. No. Thank you. Okay, a reminder that we have a fellowship in between chapel services today. So feel free to go in there and have some coffee and juice and visit for a while. We also are starting the sign-up sheets. Have y'all missed the sign-up sheets? I know you have. I've missed the sign-up sheets. So... we're going to have sign-up sheets, so anything you want to sign up for, it's in there. Also, I wanted to look at these beautiful flowers this morning. Those flowers are in celebration of Julie Turner Merberg's 52nd birthday. That's Linda and Larry's daughter. So, anyway, we're glad to see Larry back. He had a little surgery this week. And it looks like he's here and teaching Sunday school this morning and doing great. On the back of your bulletin, we did something new this week. We put all the things that are going to be happening this week at the chapel. And so we want to make sure you see that in case you want to join something or be involved in something. It shows you that on Monday morning, 7:30, we'll be doing the Lynx Fellowship over at the 19th hole over at the Old Course. So we would love for you to join us for that if you can do it. I do believe that's all the announcements I have. We're so glad you're here. Don't forget Fellowship 242 on Wednesday nights. We would love to see you there. Let's say a prayer before we start our prelude this morning. Dear God, we just love this chapel, and we love this community so much, and we're so blessed by it. God, it's by your hand that this chapel has been built, and we just pray for your guidance as we go forward and as our community grows and as we know what to do to serve this community, because we do want to be servants for your kingdom. God, we love you so much, and it is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Paula. Wonderful, merciful Savior, right? We haven't sung that. You can expect to sing that sometime soon. Wasn't that pretty? It's a beautiful hymn. So today, at least at the beginning, I'd like to reacquaint you with the hymnals in your pew. We're a little space constrained on some Sundays, and today we're going to sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, which is number 16 in your hymnal, and the words are not in your bulletin, so you're almost, maybe you have it memorized, I don't know. Let's stand and sing All Hail the Power.
The Apostles' Creed and Prayer, if you will please join me in reading this. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. and there will be come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and everlasting. Amen. If you'll bow your heads with me, please. Almighty Father, we give thanks today for the friendships in our lives. Lord, this life isn't meant to be lived alone, so we are grateful for the people who walk alongside us, supporting us, loving us, and encouraging us. We cannot do it all alone, but are better together. Help us to be more aware and gracious to our friends, appreciating them and accepting their help. Help us to be a better friend too, supporting, loving, and encouraging others. Lord, lead us to find and cultivate deeper friendships and be a good friend in all that we do. Shower your blessings upon us and those that we call friends, that you may ever be in our midst. Bind us together, Lord, for a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. Lord, let our friends know that they are the family that we choose and that you guide our path every day. All these things we ask in your name. Amen.
You may be seated. Let's sing 10,000 Reasons together.
Oh,
for it.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is Proverbs 27:9. Let's read God's word together. Perfume and incense bring joy to the heart, and the pleasantness of a friend springs from their heartfelt advice. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
If you still have your hymnal handy, Jesus is all the world to me is number 512, but the words are in your bulletin.
The marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors, in the courtroom no debate. Work on earth has been suspended as the king comes through the gate. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed. Broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children and the ages, hand in hand, stand all aglow, who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. I can hear the chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng, the flurry of God's trumpets, spell to the end of sin and wrong. The orbs and robes are now unfolding, heaven's grandstand all in place. Heaven's choir is now assembled. Start to sing Amazing Grace. Oh, the King is coming. The King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for you.
Thank you, Kathleen and Peggy. How long have y'all been singing together?
Since birth. So some 40 years they've been singing together. Yes. I tell you, what a blessing it is. In case you don't know, these are sisters. They are sitting on opposite sides of the... See, I noticed that. I don't know. That's just to balance things out, but... Yeah, but what a blessing it is to be able to have songs of faith and those that you've sung over the years and over the course of life, and to be able to share in that time together. There's something special about sisters and brothers and those other family members that make up part of your life as well. But as you can tell, we've also, and kind of the theme today, we're talking about friends and the importance of those friends. It's been said that people aren't really just looking for a friendly church. They're looking for friends, deep, lasting friendships. Despite the technology that we have that we can hold in our hand and we can look at a friend's list, despite the fact that we can be connected to individuals across the world, literally, there's nothing that takes the place of those personal interactions and shared experiences. True friends, the kind of friends that we can depend on, those who know us, those who know our hearts down to the bone and even to our soul, those friends that we can laugh with and we can cry with, and those that we can basically just tell anything to. It's a friend who says things like, I'm here for you. How can I help? Yeah, my kid does that too. I'm listening. I'll be there. or of course you can wear sweatpants. The power of friendship can take on a spiritual dimension as well. It's looking at somebody that's going through a time of grief or loss and saying again, I'm here for you and I'm praying for you. Or it's Sunday morning, I'd love to come by and pick you up and let's share in this time of devotion together. It's a bond that's something that can take us from going through some of the mediocrity of life and some of the issues and troubles and trials of life, and to be able to have those that have that listening ear, those deep, meaningful friendships. So I want us to look at a passage of Scripture today over in 1 Samuel chapter 18. 1 Samuel chapter 18, there in the Old Testament, early part of the Old Testament. And look at some spiritual guidelines as we consider friendships. It's not something we always think about in church, that friends are important. There's a spiritual aspect to that. But there is, and it's something that as we think about church fellowship and the importance of fellowship, coming together and being able to take time and to share with each other, the importance of those friendships, both in the walls of the church as well as outside the church. So there's a story of a couple of friends over in chapter 18 of 1 Samuel, beginning in verse 1. After David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. From that day, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return home to his family. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off the robe that he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic and even his sword and his bow and his belt. Let's consider some things this morning as we come to worship and as we take in a portion of God's word and then take that word to the world in which we live. Let me encourage you, first of all, to be receptive to God-given friendships. To be receptive to those God-given friendships. We look at David and Jonathan. They had a lot in common. They were both Jewish. They were brought up with similar values. They were also valiant warriors. Now, if you remember back 100 years ago, when we were on the chapel in the park or on the lawn, it seems like 100 years ago. But back in the chapel on the lawn, back in the summer, I did preach two sermons one on David and one on Jonathan. Jonathan was the one over in chapter 14 that, along with his armor bearer, he went valiantly into the heart of the Philistine army and won an unlikely victory. We see over in chapter 17, it's the famous story of David and Goliath, that David wasn't just in the army, he came to assist his brothers, and he was a boy with a slingshot and a rock, and he showed of his valiant, brave spirit, and he won the fight. Not only were they both valiant, they were both godly. When Jonathan left the comfort of the camp to engage with the Philistines, he said, "Let's go across to them. Perhaps the Lord will do a miracle for us. It doesn't matter how many enemy troops are there." And if you remember, it was somewhat foolhardy for him to do so, but he's like, "Hey, if God is in charge and God wants us to do this, then what's the problem? Let's go for it." He was valiant and he was godly. It was also David, again, who comes to the camp of those shaking in his sandals, and he says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he would dare to taunt the armies of the living God?" Again, a very bold statement, and one that came not just from a brave heart, but came from a godly heart as well. They both had a strong, active, vocal faith. We see over in chapter 18 that David meets with King Saul, the king who had ruled for some 42 years. But because of his disobedience, he was about to give up his reign. So then we come through the verse we just read, and we see that there is an introduction to Saul's son, Jonathan, and then David, this shepherd boy. And it says, after they had finished talking, after David had, immediately after the killing of the giant, and as he met with King Saul, after he had finished talking with Saul, the king, Jonathan, Saul's son, became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. There was a bond there. Now, this is probably not language that I would think that most of us men would use, that there was this type of language, but we all, both men and women, we can identify that there are some people that we can instantly identify with. There are some people that instantly we have a bond with. And there is something that you think in your heart, this can be something that's long-lasting. So just as there's an influence we talked about last week with our fathers and men in our lives, there's an incredible influence with our friends, those that we call our friends. There was immediate connection between the two. It was a connection that was God-planned and God-ordained. Now, hopefully, you have several acquaintances, and there are several people that you would consider a friend. And I use the word friend in that sense just as Jesus would use the word neighbor, that there needs to be a broad scope of who we consider to be friends. It could be your neighbor down the street. It could be somebody casually that you know at the chapel. It could be somebody that bags your groceries. It could be that individual that you go to your favorite restaurant and you always ask for this waiter or this waitress. There can be a certain friendship. I got a call this week from one of our chapel members who's traveling, and she said that Pastor, I had to call you because I've been thinking about what you've been saying the last few weeks about being an influence and touching people's lives and in the community and how we can have an impact on that. And then she went on to tell me about a project that she had and that she was able to share some food and meet some people and to have that neighborly conversation. Well, that conversation on the phone warmed my heart in two ways. One is that she actually listened to my sermon. I mean, who would have thunk it, right? I know. And as I thought about my sermons, I'm like, yeah, I guess that's been kind of the common theme. We've talked about people moving into White Bluff and to the surrounding area and the importance of reaching out and our impact and influence in the church. So, yeah, those are all very, very important things. That warmed my heart. Because again, it shows that maybe some of that message is coming across, which I know you know as well. But the other part of that is that she was willing to put some feet to the prayers and some feet to the action. Not only was she saying, thank you for that talk and the inspiration, but also I've been able to do some things. And what she shared was somewhat outside of her comfort level. So I just want to mention that there are those, when we think of friendships, it can be a very broad thing. And there could be some people that God brings into your lives that are also God-ordained, that he's saying and whispering in our ear, this is a person that needs something. It may be a smile. It may be a word of encouragement. It may be just an invitation. It could be several things. People that you may or may not really even know. You think about those concentric circles, that there are many of those outside of your everyday conversation. And not just in White Bluff or Hill County. It could be if you're traveling in Dallas or Houston or wherever, that as a body of Christ, that we are able to have an impact upon people that we meet. But when you think about the very core of your relationships, the very core of the ones who give you strength, along with family, I believe that God has given us some very dear friends. They may be friends that you've known for a few months. It could be for a few years. It could be for a few decades. Those friends that you know are again, closer than a brother, closer than a sister, that you can depend on, that you can call upon, that you can know that they will be there with you. But when you think about the core friendships, let me just encourage you, and this would be a great message for our young people, but it's also a message for all ages. is that be sure at the very core relationships, the friendships that we make, that they truly have that God-fearing attitude, to have and individuals that are like-minded, that are encouraging, that strengthen you, that don't push you down and push you away, but those individuals that are dedicated to say that together, that we have a partnership together, and to build those kind of friendships. That can be difficult. C.S. Lewis, the author, points out that most people who simply want friends never make any. Jonathan didn't approach David and say, "Hey, I need a friend," but rather their friendship formed out of their common devotion to God. You see, one of the great things we can do in coming to the chapel is to be part of worship, to be part of fellowships, to be able to come together on Sundays and on Wednesdays when we can, to be part of a care group, to be part of other connection type groups, and to be able to get to know people and to be able to befriend them and to be able to grow in that friendship. To be able to say, "Lord, maybe this individual is someone that you placed into my heart and my life that we can grow together." That's not just making friends, it's building relationships that can strengthen no matter what situation comes our way. We need to be open to these God-ordained friendships. We also need to be open to unlikely friendships. Let's look again at David and Jonathan. The story of David and Jonathan, they had many similarities, but they also had a lot of differences. Jonathan was the son of a king. He knew all of the finer things in life. He knew of life in the palace. David, at this point, he was also, he was the son of a shepherd. He lived and worked in the fields. His cologne was the scent of sheep. He washed his clothes in woolite. I've learned in my preaching that if you pause for a second, that maybe you receive something. If not, you just go on. It's David, the shepherd boy, was also in line to be the next king of Israel. Samuel, the prophet, had already gone to the house of Jesse and anointed David as king. And now it was just a matter of time. Now think about that. David will be the next king. The next king following Saul will not be the prince Jonathan. It will be David. You would have thought that Jonathan would look down on David and resent him, despise him, ostracize him. Instead, it says here in verse 1 that Jonathan loved David as a brother. Now, if you know the story here in chapter 18, I'm going to share just a couple of things. Saul didn't feel that way. In fact, let me just skip down to verse 6. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, or Goliath, the women came out from the towns of Israel to meet King Saul and was singing and dancing and joyful songs and timbrels and lyres. And as they danced, they sang these words: "Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands." Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They were credited David. He said they credited David with tens of thousands, but for me, only thousands. What more can he get but from the kingdom? And then it says, and from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. "I'm going to watch you, boy, because you're up to no good. You're killing tens of thousands. I only got thousands," and they're noticing. But he goes on. The next day, an evil spirit from God came forcibly on Saul. He was prophesying in his house. And while David was playing the lyre instrument, as he usually did, Saul had a spear in his hand, and he hurled it, saying to himself, "I'll pin David to the wall." But David eluded him twice. So there's something going on here. Yeah. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David but had departed from him. So there was something about Jonathan that didn't follow in line with his father, Saul. You see, Saul had lots of jealousy. Saul had lots of animosity. Jonathan, rather, loved him as a brother. Now, let me just say that envy can be a real enemy to friendship. Sometimes it's easier for us, for our friends, when they're doing well, and we can pat them on the back, say, man, I'm so proud. But then when they get the new car, or they get the hole in one, or, you know, you're happy for them, but yeah, I wish it was me. I'm a better golfer than they are. I don't know why. Yeah. You know, envy. Things that we want to be happy, but we're not. And sometimes it shows. And sometimes that envy can just take on a life of its own as well. And we can be like Saul, and I don't love him. I want to pin him to the wall because I'm afraid or I'm upset or I'm angry or whatever emotion we have. We need to be not like those who have that green eye of envy, but rather to say, I'm willing to follow the Lord. I'm willing to follow my God who gives me these God-ordained friendships. And as I have these friendships, that we can rejoice together as well and to be that true friend. If we allow God, God can make some very unlikely people in our lives and make them our friends. Susie has a couple of friends that from college that if you know them back in college, they seem to be opposite in a lot of ways. And yet years later, they're still some of the best friends that she's ever had. Be committed to lasting friendships would be the last thing. Lasting friendships, they are anchors to the past. I talked last week that I grew up in a military family, but my dad retired when I was in high school, junior high, and I spent junior high and high school there in San Antonio. And there's a couple of friends that were friends from church, but also friends from school that I have known since junior high. Now, that's a long time for me. You know, friends that you've known over the years and we still keep in touch with. I mentioned that one of the friends that I have, and he and his wife have visited sometimes. He's a pastor of the church in Princeton, north of McKinney. But Stan and I would carpool together from San Antonio to Brownwood, to Howard Payne. And it's about 3.5-hour drive. So I was fortunate to have a 10-year-old Mercury Comet. That was a cool car. I had a Vega before that. That wasn't so cool. I was, my handle, remember the CB days? I was the Vagabond. Yeah. Anyway, so I had this Comet, Mercury Comet, and we would just pack into that car. Now, I would give Stan from San Antonio a ride to Brownwood, and we would have all of our stuff when we start the new semester, clothes and, you know, all the paraphernalia and everything, and it was packed to the gills. Now, why would I do that? Why would I just stuff everything in that car and to get to college with my friend? It's because he was my friend. And we spent years there at college together. Well, one I think it was my junior year, we were driving back, again, stuffed because it was between semesters. And there was another friend that was in a car in front of us, and we had heard that he had had an accident. He wasn't hurt, but his car was not drivable. And so we kind of helped him out and worked out some things. Well, he needed to get home. And so here we are packed with my stuff, Stan's stuff, and then Mark is his name, and he's about 6'3", with all his stuff. And so I said, hey, Mark, you need to ride home? It's only about 2 hours left, you know. So Mark comes in. He's sitting at the bucket seats. He's sitting in the middle console. His head's hitting the roof. He's got his knees kind of like this. All his stuff is, again, stuffed in the back, and we make our way to San Antonio. Now, why would I do that? I'll tell you why. Because Mark was my friend, and I wanted to do anything I could to be able to get him home. You see, God allows us to to have those kind of friends, to be able to come together and to be able to be bonded together, willing to go the extra mile. We see this with Jonathan and David. Look again in chapter 18, verse 3. Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan did certain things. He took off his robe that he was wearing, and he gave it to David, along with his tunic, and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. So here's David, who is taking his place to be the king, and he says, David, I love you like a brother. Take all this. Take the tunic and take my bow. Take all this. And it was almost as if there was this inauguration. Envy was not there. It was simply saying, I know that God has placed you here. Now notice what else he gave him, though, was the sword. If you remember back in the story of Jonathan, it was very clear there were only two swords in the entire kingdom. Saul had one, Jonathan had one. Jonathan is taking his most probably prized possession and weapon, and he's presenting this to David. You see, he didn't just love him on the surface, he went the extra mile as well. We need those kind of friends. Those kind of friends just don't grow up. We see them to be cultivated, and we grow and we mature, and we say at times, I'm sorry for this, and I wish this, and can you help me with this? And it's that vulnerability and those things that we look back, and whether these are friends that we've had since junior high or those that we've made just in the past year, to be able to grow those and know that it's a spiritual process as well to be able to follow our God. Let me just say this too before we close on talking about friends. Over in John chapter 15, Jesus, who has been with these disciples, as the master and the hearers, he's seen as the teacher, the rabbi, and the students. But he says here in John 15 something to them that applies also to you and to me. He says in verse 12, my command is this, love each other as I have also loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down his life for his friends. Jesus is predicting his own death. Greater love has no man than this, than to lay down his life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. And instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I've learned from my Father, I have made known to you. Jesus, the eternal God, the one who emptied himself upon the earth, the creator of the heavens and the earth. He says to this group of men and the women and for believers, for you and for me, I love you with an everlasting love. In fact, I call you my friend. Let that resonate just a bit in that reminder that we are not just worshiping a God who is out there somewhere. That holy, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent Lord is with us. And our Lord even looks at us and considers us to be a friend. Let us be the kind of friend that we need to be with others and to give that that forbearance and to be able to give of ourselves even when we don't feel like being a great friend. Let us seek out friends that and to be open to friendships and knowing that God will open doors that we really didn't even imagine that could be open and new friends. And most of all, let us be those who look to Jesus as the friend above all friends and to be grateful not only for what he has done, but for who he is and the joy that he continually gives. To be our example, to be the friend that God has called us to be. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the gift of friends. And Lord, so many times we take for granted those that are close to us and those that we can call at a moment's notice. Father, we pray, Lord, for those the deep friendships that you have provided for us. Lord, help us always to be open to others that we may or may not even associate with, or even consider to be a friend. Lord, that we can broaden that aperture of our lives and know that you truly are leading individuals into our lives, Lord, to be able to minister to them, to befriend them, to encourage them, Lord, ultimately to lead them into your arms. Father, we pray that we can value the friendships that we have. And Lord, as we consider the words that you spoke to the disciples, Lord, also to be individuals that know that the greatest of all friends is through you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing, Share His Love. Lord, dismiss us with your blessing. Fill our hearts with joy and peace. Let each of us, your love possessing, triumph in redeeming grace. As we depart, we give you thanks for your gospel's joyful sound. May the fruits of your salvation flourish in our hearts and lives, that we may bring glory to you and be found faithful to your truth. In Christ's name, amen.